Hi everybody, good morning, I think it's still the morning today. My name is Hatim Azim. I'm a doctor in communication and media studies. I got my degree last year, just 364 days ago. My PhD thesis was about the military media of Islamic resistance, the military arm of Hezbollah, history, messages and objectives, or by other words, it's about Hezbollah's media discourse. I'm originally from Lebanon. Before I came to Australia, I used to live in Kuwait for 4 years. I worked there as a journalist. I was senior editor of studies, profiles, opinion pieces, conducting interviews with key scholars who used to visit Kuwait from the United States and United Kingdom and other Western countries. Here in Australia, before in Lebanon, I finished political sciences and I have a couple of degrees in journalism and communication studies. In Australia, I studied Master of Journalism and Communication in the University of New South Wales before going to Queensland and get married there. And now I'm here in Sydney and I'm finishing Master of Public Relations and advertising, hopefully to graduate this semester at the University of New South Wales. First of all, I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners, custodians of the land in which we stand, and I would like to pay my respects to their elders, past and present. My topic today is a conflict over the future of Syria from Hezbollah's perspective, the axis of resistance at stake. This is a roadmap of my presentation today, the introduction, the aim of the paper, question, objectives, hypothesis, literature review, and finding. In the introduction, I think few of my colleagues now pointed to the key players in the Syrian conflict. I categorize them into the anti-Syrian regime and the pro-Syrian regime. There are the international powers who are anti-Syrian regime, United States, United Kingdom, and France, and the regional power, Israel, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, and Qatar, and the military organizations, which is the opposition groups, ISIS and similar factions, and the pro-Syrian regime, we have the international powers, mainly Russia and China. The regional power is Iran, and militant organizations, mainly Hezbollah. I don't want to use the same phrase which has been used by the late journalist Mohammed Hassan al-Haytham, who described Hezbollah as the soft power, as the key player, original key player, and the softer power, which is opposing to the classical power of the government. Some scholars and observers may point to Egypt as a significant regional player. I think, in my point of view, Egypt needs the time to recapture its regional rule due to its domestic upheavals. If Egypt recaptures its regional rule, it has an impact on the future of the conflict. Both the Egyptian and Syrian Arab armies have historically close ties because these two countries have united for nearly 3 years between 1958 and 1961, and the then called the state was called United Arab Republic. Historically, it has been considered that the security, and still the security of Syria is considered as a part of the Egyptian national security. But we don't know the time frame when Egypt will come back to the scene and what the rule should be. Although we hear from time to time that they are focusing on the Syrian Arab army to stay without fragmentation, without decomposing, or disarming maybe we have the same situation that happened in Iraq post 2003. The overall aim. In my research regarding Hezbollah's history, ideology, and discourse, I found a gap in literature related to why this ideological Shia party ally firmly with an Arab nationalist, secular, socialist regime. The overall aim of the paper is to investigate why Hezbollah involved in the Syrian war to support the regime. Thus, the paper intends to answer the following question. What is the reason they added that led Hezbollah, the Islamist party, to engage in Syrian war to support a secular Ba'athist regime? The aim to achieve, to answer this question and to achieve the aim of the paper is undertaking a literature review related to Hezbollah's involvement in Syrian war and reviewing ideological Hezbollah's ideology and its policy. However, the hypothesis postulated are Hezbollah involved in Syrian war to support its ally, the Syrian regime, because both Hezbollah and Syrian regime are part of the axis of resistance. Second hypothesis is Hezbollah involved in the Syrian war to fight terrorism, ISIS, and other factions, and hence to protect its back. And I think you have witnessed in the maps the Lebanese-Syrian borders and how they are big. And I think in the northern Bekaa, which is the Lebanese one of the biggest Lebanese districts, which is on the border between Lebanon and Syria, there are mixed villages. The majority of these villages are from Shiites Muslims, and it can be considered Hezbollah's stronghold. And usually it used to be clashes between Hezbollah and Syrian opposition factions, including ISIS and Al-Nusra Front, which changed its color into, sorry, its color instead of name, to Jabhat Fatah al-Sham. Literature review. I want to point to four topics in my literature. Firstly, a historical relation between Hezbollah and Syrian regime, Hezbollah and the Arab uprising, the image of Hezbollah in the Arab media, taking case of Al Jazeera and Arabia, and geopolitics and ideology. The relation between Hezbollah and the Syrian regime goes back to 1982, shortly after the Israeli invasion to Lebanon, when the 10 Syrian troops in Lebanon allowed the newborn Islamic Jihadi party to obtain the means of their military power and receive the Iranian military support that was crossing the Syrian border towards Hezbollah's training camps in Bekaa Valley. At the time, Lebanon was in a political and military turmoil because it was facing a decade of civil war and its capital Beirut occupied by the Israeli forces, the Israeli army. And even the Lebanese civil war erupted this month in April 13, 1975. And the Syrian troops entered Lebanon in 1976. The troops deployed of the Syrian Arab army in Lebanon were the practical arms that secured Damascus' interest in this neighboring country that suffered geopolitical fragmentation and sectarianism. Its capital, Beirut, occupied by the Israeli forces, and hence the country lacked the centralized political decision. As times go by, Hezbollah confirmed its military superiority and its social success. The military success translated an unconditional Israeli gradual withdrawal from Lebanon reached its peak in May 2000. In this vein, when it turned into the key regional political player in Lebanon, post-Taif Accord in 1989 that ended the Lebanese Civil War. Taif Agreement or Accord has been broken by Saudi Arabia and the Arab League, and the Lebanese key figures and delegations they met in the city of Taif in Saudi Arabia, and which ended the Lebanese Civil War and led to the amendment to the Lebanese Constitution. Syria backed Hezbollah at the time, and still, and worked with the Lebanese government to consider this party a resistance movement, not a militia, should be disarmed. Because what has happened, the Taif agreement, as a result, and amended the constitution, dissolved all the Lebanese militias because they engaged, they involved in the Lebanese civil war. However, they considered Hezbollah a resistance movement. One of the stages that confirmed the Syrian support of Hezbollah was the Israeli 16-day war. In this month, in 1996, and named by the Israelis the Great of Wrath against Hezbollah, it used to be. This war ended by April agreement that aimed to protect the civilians of both sides of the conflict. The articles of this agreement were supervised, reviewed, and revised by the Syrian President Hafez al-Assad himself. And I want to point in my reading the literature that Hafez al-Assad, in his pen, amended some of the phrases of the agreement, which Hezbollah didn't accept it at the time. And it was proposed by the former Secretary of State, Warren Christopher. After the Israeli withdrawal from South Lebanon in 2000, except for Shebe Hasan, the Israeli army started using a tactic to respond to Hezbollah's military operations against its troops. Thus, the Israeli Air Force was targeting Syrian garrisons in Lebanon. Hezbollah's military arm, as a result, started responding promptly and swiftly on these attacks. When the Syrian government decided in 2005 to withdraw its troops from Lebanon shortly after the assassination of the former Lebanese president, Rafik Hariri, and as a result of the international pressures on Syria, Hezbollah organized in Beirut on the 8th of March 2005 one of the biggest rallies in the modern history of Lebanon to thank Syria and its army for their massive sacrifice for the sake of Lebanon. In a similar vein, when the July War of 2006 erupted between the Israeli army and Hezbollah's military arm, the Islamic Resistance, Syria was on the edge of military intervention if the Israeli troops reached strategic points in Western Bethel. Hezbollah and the Arab uprising. You know, all that, some call it the Arab Spring, this uprising, and I don't think it has been a spring. I think it has been an autumn and turned into a cold winter. In reviewing literature related to Hezbollah's standpoint from what so-called the Arab Spring that started to occupy the political scene in the Arab world by the end of 2010, it can be concluded that this party blessed all the uprisings in Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Bahrain, and Yemen, although it considered that there is a domestic political opposition in Syria. Hezbollah considers that there is a conspiracy against Syria and its government. At the early stages of the Syrian uprising and before the emergence of the terrorist groups in Syria, one of the scholars, first scholars who wrote about Hezbollah's policy ideology, and she has her PhD from Birmingham University of the United Kingdom. Her name is Anna Saad Al-Ghrayli. She summarized Hezbollah's pretext of supporting the Syrian regime in 2011, saying, first, this regime's relationship with and position towards the American-Israeli project in the region, and second, the potential for reforms. Regarding the image of Hezbollah in the Arab world, I would like to point that the media played a significant role in this regard. I point to two anti-Hezbollah. You can consider one of them completely anti, another one very debate about it. Anti-Hezbollah and its role in Lebanon and the region. The Arab media, particularly the influential satellite television stations, reflect generally governmental standpoints. In this regard, I point to Al Jazeera that reflects Qatar view and Al Arabiya that reflects Saudi Arabia view. Al Jazeera was a channel, was described Hezbollah as a resistance movement during the war between Hezbollah's military arm and the Israeli army in July 2006. Al Jazeera was the first satellite channel that allowed Hezbollah to interview the most wanted man, as Ghassan bin Jidda described, Sayyid Hassan Nasrullah at the time. And I think he interviewed Sayyid Hassan Nasrullah more than once at, during the war of 2006. Shortly after the end of the war, the then Emir of Qatar visited Hezbollah's stronghold area in southern district of Beirut to witness the destruction, and he received a warm welcome from Hezbollah's official and the civilian. As a result of its aid, Hezbollah's media raised its slogan, "Thank you, Qatar." When Hezbollah engaged in civil war to support the regime, Qatar, which support Muslim Brotherhood opposition in the Arab world, including Syria, Muslim Brotherhood in Syria, does not maintain the same relation with Hezbollah, and hence Al Jazeera started pointing that Hezbollah turned from a resistance movement to a supporter of a brutal regime. On the other hand, the relation between Saudi Arabia and Hezbollah was unstable. After one day of the outbreak of the July War of 2006, an official Saudi statement published by Saudi press agency describing Hezbollah's capturing of two Israeli soldiers by uncalculated adventure, pointing there the statement that the kingdom sees that it is time for these elements to single-handedly shoulder full responsibility for this irresponsible behavior, and that the burden of ending the crisis it has created falls on them, means Hezbollah alone. Although this statement didn't name Hezbollah directly, it was known that it started in this party, and its term uncalculated adventure was subject for its casing analysis. After one day of the statement, Sir Hassan Nasrallah responded harshly against Saudi Arabia and the Arab countries that are in the same line. He responded against, also against the Egyptian president. Although the relation between Saudi Arabia and Hezbollah has been restored after that war, the gap of trust hasn't bridged, because both have polar agendas. Saudi Arabia considers Hezbollah a Shiite movement loyal to Iran, believing in Wilayat Faqih, the rule of denounce the rule of the Jews. On the other hand, Hezbollah considers Saudi Arabia liable to the emergence of extremist and terrorist organizations that consider Shiites as non-Muslims and cause bloodshed. Although the party accused Saudi Arabia of supporting the Bahraini regime to oppress the citizens and killing the Yemenis through airstrikes and siege. Al Arabiya satellite television campaigns not only against Hezbollah's engagement in the Syrian war, but also it also highlights Hezbollah's losses in Syria and labels it as a party operates in Lebanon and the region rather than a Lebanese party. Regarding the geopolitics and ideology, and as noted earlier in the literature, Syria is considered the vital vein for Hezbollah. During the July War of 2006, thousands of Lebanese civilians, particularly the Shiite Muslims, fled their towns to Syria. Syria has been considered Hezbollah's safe haven. And all of us, I think, if we review the media, we remember that the assassination of Hezbollah's former commander, Ahmad Mughni, in Damascus in February 2008. And many of Hezbollah's commanders and officers were targeted in Syria by the Israelis, and now by rebel groups as well. And even by Israelis, Ahmad Mughni's son has been killed by an Israeli airstrike 2 years ago. Without Syria, it seems difficult for Hezbollah to build and maintain its military arsenal. It might worth to note that the Israeli air raid on Syria from 31st of January 2013 to 17th of March 2017, under the pretext of attacking military convoys related to Hezbollah, were 18. As a result, Syria is considered for Hezbollah the nerve of resistance. Hezbollah, in its political charter in 2009, pointed to the significance of resistance instead of Islamic resistance, which it is the name of its military arm. It seems that the party considers that there are other nationalists and secular who are not Shiites, maybe, but however, they are part of the resistance and its culture. Notably, there were warnings in 2004 from the king of Jordan, from what he described, the Shiite Christians, the Zebinos, Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Hezbollah in Lebanon. And I think it will be one of the lectures later on about the acts of resistance that will delve further in this regard. Although Hezbollah's mutual political and military interest with the Syrian regime, it has also religious interest because there are Shia shrines in Syria, mainly in Damascus, Lady Zainab and Lady Ruqayya. Thus, Hezbollah sent soldiers to protect them, mainly the shrine of Lady Zainab, Sayyidah Zainab, from attacks and destruction by Takfiri, who accused others of apostasy. Many Sunni and Shiite Muslims use this term, Takfiri, to refer to the members and supporters of Al-Qaeda and similar groups. We remember in 2000, by the end of 2005, what has happened in Iraq, the exploding city of Samarra, when they exploded the shrine, Shiite Muslim shrine, Al-Askariyan, and you know this was a fuel for the sectarian war in Iraq. It adds further fuel, and this is what Hezbollah, I think, is worried about. If any destruction happened to Lady Zainab shrine in the city of Damascus, it will fuel further sectarian conflict, not only in Syria, maybe in other areas of the Arab world. In a similar vein, Hezbollah is at war with these groups, which targeted its stronghold in northern Bekaa and southern district of Beirut by car bombs and suicide attacks. The last suicide attacks happened in Beirut. It's to be after the French attacks in one day. It used to be in November 14, 2015, as I remember. However, it didn't take that explosion massive coverage in the press because they were used to focus further on what has happened in France at the time. In this context, some of these groups launched missiles toward villages in northern Bekaa before it has been stopped as a result of Hezbollah's extensive military intervention. In summary, in my research, I found that Hezbollah has a moral obligation to support the Syrian regime. And I didn't provide further examples because it would take more time. How Syria helped Hezbollah to build its military arsenal, to gain military capabilities, even though to have its international voice with Iran. The Syrian regime is Hezbollah's ally, and hence Hezbollah can't accept changing the secular regime by opposing one, even if it's an Islamic regime. The holy Shia shrines in Damascus are sacred and symbolic to Shiite Muslims in general and Hezbollah in particular. Hezbollah attacks ISIS and similar groups in Syria to prevent them from spreading toward Lebanon. At last but not least, I would like to pay tribute to the innocent victims of the wars and violence in the Middle East, and to all people and even animals who suffer from malnutrition and war around the globe. As I express my sympathy and empathy with them, I am speechless. When I see a child cries, injured, burnt, or killed, although some of these victims didn't receive coverage or sufficient coverage by many media outlets, maybe because they are not worthy victims in their media agenda. They are for sure a true call to wake up our conscience. Oh, victims, I love you all, and I'm very sorry because I don't have anything to offer you except my words, my emotions, and my memory. Where you lunch forever. Thank you very much.